Yeah, let's go ahead and do it. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm sure we're going to have a bunch of people trickling in here in the next few minutes. But if you're just joining again, make sure that you let us know where you're calling in from and what you're currently up to, so we can in the chat bar, so we can really tailor the conversation to you. Oh, and Pranima, those chats are actually coming in the question bar, so you can see it there. We've got a lot of answers coming in. Yeah.
Okay.
Awesome. So again, thank you for joining us. We're going to be talking about A Techie's Guide to Public Speaking, Interviewing, and Making Up Moves to Level Your Career. And my name is Nicole. I'm on the marketing team at Flatiron School, and we're so excited to be partnering with Engineer and Pornima on this webinar. So just a couple of short housekeeping items before we get started onto the next slide. So yeah, just a couple things. First, making sure that you're tweeting anything that you think is interesting or you want to remember, share with the world. These are our Twitter handles here. And definitely don't hesitate to ask questions throughout in the question bar. We'll be answering them as we go through. And sort of before we jump into the main conversation, just a little bit more about Flatiron School, in case you're not familiar. So Flatiron School is a school for people who love to create. We teach people to become programmers. Our mission is kind of helping people learn to love to code. And we teach all sorts of things, a lot of full stack web development programs, as well as front end and iOS programs. We have an online campus and we have a New York City campus. So if you're interested, you can definitely visit our website, flatironschool.com, to see what courses we're hosting. Currently a new HTML course we just launched, also full stack web development in New York City and on our online campus, as well as iOS development. So we look forward to hopefully seeing you online. We have some free tracks at learn.co. And yeah, that's Flatiron School. We're really excited to help people change their lives and their careers with code. And with that, you're going to really dive in and get some great information on how you can sort of approach taking that change and making those moves to level up your career. So go ahead and take it away.
Thank you, Nicole. Awesome. Well, thanks everybody for telling me where you're from. Whoever hasn't yet, feel free to. And I have a couple of questions for you before we get started. How many of you in here have at least given, one presentation, let's say in the last 3 months? Go ahead and just enter yes into the question bar so I get a sense. Oh, okay. A couple people already. That's awesome. All right. Oh, okay. I see one no, lots of yeses. Okay, great. Now, of those of you who said yes, how did the presentation go? Was it smooth sailing, or did you feel like there were some things that you wanted to work on? And for those of you who said no, what's holding you back from giving a presentation? Okay, pretty good. I see somebody said pretty good presentation. Okay. Oh, pretty smooth. All right. Okay, I see pacing was an issue. The first 5 minutes are shaky and then it's smooth sailing. Delivery could have been better. Okay. All right, a lot of you said that you're afraid, there's some anxiety. All right. Okay, that's fine. We'll cover all of that. Well, I'm at least happy that a number of you have gotten up and done one presentation in the last 3 months. For some of you who haven't yet, we will, or at least I will cover some techniques around how you can get started. And I see some people saying QA is nerve-wracking, anxiety, fear about forgetting something. I'm going to cover a number of those topics today. And whatever I don't cover, don't worry, I'm going to save enough time for Q&A at the end so that you can ask me any questions you have. So just to give you a little background about myself, I have been public speaking for, about 20 plus years. And a lot of people wonder, like, how is that even possible, right? Well, the truth is, I was one of those really shy kids growing up, and I knew that life was going to be a challenge if I continued to be shy. And so, in the most awkward years of my life, in middle school and high school, I decided to join the speech and debate team. So, yes, I was one of those speech and debate nerds. And then after that, I think doing that experience or going through it was really great because it really set me up for success. You know, I nailed my college interview, I nailed my first job interview, and then I went on to do more complicated things like raising capital for my startups. And so I'm really glad that I had that experience early on, but that doesn't mean that I still don't suffer from stage fright or I don't get nervous. In fact, in this picture here, this was taken just a few months back at a Google event called Women Tech Makers, and it was a lightning talk, and I was extremely nervous before the event. In fact, right before I got on stage, I think I like chugged a bottle of water because I had cotton mouth before I got up there. So, you know, it happens, but what I'll teach you are some of the techniques for managing those nerves so that you still get up on stage and do your presentations. Okay. So I'm going to cover a number of things. I'm going to start by talking about the opportunities that come about as you do your public speaking. I know a number of you mentioned that you haven't yet because you're feeling anxious. A lot of times we worry that we don't have time because we've got to be heads down coding and shipping product. So who has time to do that? So I'll talk to you about how you can weave in public speaking into networking. And another thing I know is a lot of times people worry that they don't have expertise, right? They might think, well, I've only been coding for, you know, 2 weeks or 2 months or 2 years or 2 decades. You know, why would anybody want to hear from me? So I'll talk about how you can figure out your expertise and get up on stage and present. And then we'll transition into talking about something that you're probably all concerned in the near term, which is getting an interview and, of course, nailing the interview and then doing some negotiation while you're in that process, where public speaking techniques can also help. Okay, so the first thing is you've probably heard from a number of people that the beauty of public speaking is that doors will open. You know, you'll have a lot of visibility, but what exactly does that mean? You know, people say it like it's this end all and be all, right? Well, the truth is that when you speak, a couple things happen. The first is you get to showcase yourself, which means no one else is talking about you, and it really gives you a chance to be as authentic as possible. The second is you get to showcase what you want to showcase, meaning the projects that you've worked on, the problems that you've solved, and your own level of expertise in whatever field that is. And so you really get to control the messaging. And when you do this, a couple of things happen. The first is people take notice, right? They see that you're up there on stage or in front of a room presenting at people, and so they get interested and they want to sponsor you or champion whatever efforts that you are leading. And that could lead to something like a promotion or you taking over a project or leading a team. The other thing that it does is over time, you know, you start to become this go-to person on these topics, which is another great place to be in, especially if you're early on in your career and you feel like maybe you're not getting the attention that you deserve. Now, for those of you who hate networking, I hate networking. I don't know if you love it, but I certainly dislike it. It always feels so awkward to be in those conversations where you're at a big conference and you're not really sure who you should be meeting, who you should be talking to, or you go to those events after work and you're at a bar, and sure, like after one drink you might feel a little bit better, but you know, it just doesn't feel all that great. There's a lot of small talk and maybe you kind of want to cut to the chase. So I personally found that the best form of networking is when I speak. Because when I speak, people come up, they notice me, they care about the topic I'm speaking about, and they ask more substantive questions. And relationships start to form, and opportunities start to emerge from that. So I don't do any more of those kind of meet and greet events anymore. I primarily focus on conferences and going to events and speaking at them, because I'm more likely to get up in front of a lot of people and develop those deeper relationships. Now, having said all that, right, I'm sure a number of you have already mentioned, well, that's great, Purnima, but I have stage fright. I'm really concerned about getting up there. I have anxiety, or I'm nervous, or I might forget my words. You know, how do I deal with all of that? Well, like I just said in the beginning, stage fright is normal. I still get it, and a lot of people who are performers or speakers who do this consistently still have stage fright. So it's not the kind of thing that you're going to eliminate altogether, but you need to learn how to manage those nerves. And so I'm going to share with you a couple techniques that will help you tremendously when it comes to stage fright. So the first is power posing. How many of you have already heard about power posing? Let me know in the chat box. Okay. Oh, a couple of people know it. Some people already love it. Great. So for those of you who are not familiar with power posing is this technique that was founded by Amy Cuddy and a couple of her colleagues who work at Harvard. And basically what they found was power posing, you know, this sort of movement, is something that people do across cultures. And they do it when they are feeling really proud or feeling really confident. So for those of you who are getting ready to watch the Olympics, or maybe you're a World Cup fanatic, you've probably seen that when people score a goal, people score a touchdown or whatever, they put their arms up in this victory sign, right? And the reason that they're doing that is because they feel confident. They feel really powerful. Well, again, this cuts across cultures. And the incredible thing is that you can actually fake it till you make it, which means you don't have to score a touchdown, you know, or a goal before you put your hands up in a victory sign. You can actually do it before a number of situations. And what ends up happening is that first, your cortisol, which is a stress hormone, starts to go down. And testosterone, which is a hormone in both men and women, and it's kind of the hormone that makes you feel confident and powerful, starts to go up. So this reaction of cortisol going down, testosterone going up, makes us feel really confident and powerful. Now, the research shows that doing this for at least 2 minutes before you get up and do a presentation, or you know, you're faced with a challenging situation, can help you to have this sort of positive reaction. Now, you might not believe the research, but I have a personal anecdote to share with you. And that's I did a TEDx talk a couple of years ago. And I don't have a lot of stage fright, but at times I get nervous. And before I did my TEDx talk, I actually felt great. You know, I practiced by myself, I practiced with my peers and a mini audience, and then I went to the East Coast to deliver it, and the day before and the day of, you know, I was feeling really good. In fact, a lot of people asked me, "How are you doing?" And I said, "I'm feeling great. I'm so ready to give this talk." And before I walked up on stage, I noticed that I started to feel a little bit nervous. And as I was walking, my knees started to shake. And I got to that red circle in the middle of the room, and my knees would not stop shaking. And I didn't know what to do. So I took a couple deep breaths and I gave my talk, but I didn't feel good about it. And after my talk, I went out to the audience, and my husband was there, and he came up to me and he said, "Great talk, you did such a good job." And I thought, yeah, you know, he's just being supportive, what does he know? And then I talked to a few other people in the audience, and they all said that I had done a good job. And I thought, okay, you know, maybe they're not lying, but it just doesn't feel like they're being completely honest, because I didn't feel like I had a good talk. And sure enough, you know, a month later, I saw the YouTube video, and I had done an okay job. I'd actually done better than I thought, but I just didn't feel great. And I shared my experience with my co-author, Karen Catlin, who used to be a VP at Adobe, and she told me about power posing. And before her TEDx talk, you know, she gets nervous a lot. She did this, and she said, "I did it. I felt great. It was the best talk I ever gave in my entire life. You should try it out." And so basically, I took her advice, and I was like, "All right, I'll try anything." So now, before I give any talk, I do the power pose for a couple minutes, or anytime I'm faced with a stressful situation. So, you know, we gave a talk at Grace Hopper, which is a huge conference, and it was about 400 people in the audience who all did this. And I can't see all of you, but I want you all to stand up right now, wherever you are, and do the power pose. We'll just kind of practice it just to kind of get you used to it, all right? So, wherever you are, if you're at work, if you're at home, wherever it is you are, stand up, do the power pose with me, okay? And I'll tell you when to stop. All right. And you know, you can do it like this. You can do kind of the Wonder Woman stance. You can flex some muscle. I know some people do some yoga moves. Some people like to dance. You know, whatever it is that you do to kind of open up and be expansive and feel more confident and powerful. All right? You guys can all sit down now. I hope you guys did it. All right. Now, another technique for dealing with stage fright is what we like to call meet and greet. And the way that this works, I'll explain it in a little bit, but I'm going to give you the context, right? So you show up to an event that you're speaking at, and you know, what do? The first thing when you get to the event, right? You probably get there, you set up, and then you grab this, and you start checking your email, and you're like, oh, okay, oh no, I got a bad email, right? And then all of a sudden, all that power posing that you did, you know, you're kind of hunched over your phone, you know, you kind of get rid of that positive effect, and if you get a bad email, it kind of throws you off, right? You're like, oh no, you know, something's wrong at work, or if you're a parent, maybe the teacher has given you an email saying, come in for a parent-teacher conference, right? So these are all kind of things that you don't want to be dealing with before you give a talk, because it just kind of takes away from you being present. So what we recommend is put your phone away, and instead, after you've done getting ready, go and meet people in the audience. Right, take a moment, introduce yourself, ask them, you know, where they're from, what they're looking forward to in this talk, if they have any questions about the topic, and you'll get to know your audience a little bit more. And the beauty of doing this is that once you get to know them, then when you get up on stage or you get up in front of them to present, you have a couple friendly faces in the audience. And so as you're speaking, you no longer feel like people are strangers to you, but instead, you've gotten to know them a little bit more. How many of you do this? How many of you kind of take the time to meet and greet your audience before you give a presentation? Let me know in the chat box. Okay, somebody said sometimes they do. That's good. So I just kind of have to make it a regular habit. All right, somebody said no. Okay, so try this out the next time you're giving a presentation. And it doesn't matter if you know everybody, like if it's at work versus a bigger event, right? It's always good to have a little bit of an icebreaker. Okay, and I know somebody said whenever it's possible, and sometimes the schedule doesn't allow it. And that's true. Like if you're at a big conference in front of a lot of people, sometimes you can't necessarily do that. So instead, what you could do is kind of the technique that I did at the beginning of this webinar, kind of throw out a couple of questions to that sea of audience and even get people to stand up a little bit. And you know, it's okay to probe them a little bit more, like, hey, you said you gave a presentation. Tell me what the last presentation was, right? Some people will actually be willing to do it, and that's an opportunity for you to get to know them a little bit more. Okay. So now, moving on, a lot of times after we give these suggestions to people about the power posing as well as meet and greet, they feel pretty confident, but then the concern is, you know, why would anybody care about what I have to say? I've only been coding for a couple months, a couple weeks, a couple decades. You know, I'm not really an expert. Why would anybody want to hear from me? Well, the truth is that no matter what, there's always somebody who is less experienced than you are, whether it's in a particular language or framework or even, you know, a job role that you have. And the reason that they're coming out to hear you speak is because they want to fast track their learning, right? Otherwise, they would just stay at home, do a Google search, or read a book, right? They're coming out because they want to hear your unique perspective. They want to know what your experience was. And they want to get a sense of, you know, were there some challenging moments that you went through? Because a lot of times for you, you might be a little bit ashamed that, oh, you know, it took you maybe a year to learn a language, or maybe it took you a long time to create your first app, or maybe it took you a while to get your first job, right? But if there were things that you learned in that process that you can share, you are adding a lot of value to that audience member, and you're going to help them fast track their learning, so they're not going to have to go through the same problems that you did. Now, if you're wondering, okay, but how do I actually figure out what my expertise is, we have a method called the inventory method. And the way that the inventory method works is you are going to take stock of everything that you've done, you know, projects, things that you've learned, even, you know, challenging moments that you've had for the last 3 to 12 months. And the reason we say 3 to 12 is because that's usually what's freshest in your mind, right, in terms of recalling what you've learned. But also, we're in technology and things move pretty quickly. So it's also what's going to be really relevant to folks out there who are watching your talk. Now, to give you a simple example, back when I was a founding engineer at Mint.com, I had been working there for about a couple years out of college, and just like maybe many of you, I felt, kind of still consider myself a junior engineer. Yeah, I built this prototype and launched it and scaled it, but I'm only a couple years out of college. Why would anybody want to hear what I have to say? But I thought, okay, you know what? I'm just going to get up there. I'm going to start speaking. And I signed up at a local conference. I didn't even have a topic when I signed up. I just sort of put my name down, and then I realized, what am I doing? So I went back to my team and started kind of brainstorming ideas. And what we came up with was really just sharing my experience of building a prototype, launching it, and scaling it. And it really ended up resonating with the audience because a lot of the audience members had only done one of a few of those things. Like maybe they had built a prototype, but it was sitting on their laptop, or a lot of people working at bigger companies where they were just managing, small pieces of code. They hadn't done that whole spectrum. So it was really valuable to hear my experiences, the technologies that I used, kind of the challenges that I experienced in scaling this, and as a result, they found the talk to be very valuable. Okay, so you're probably wondering, okay, but where can I speak at? What makes sense? And the truth is, there's a lot of opportunities. It's really up to you to decide where you want to speak at. And a lot of times people are looking for speakers, especially on technical tracks. There's always a dearth of high quality folks who are willing to speak. So don't hesitate to speak at a hackathon, at a conference, or even at a local meetup. Those are often great places because, again, these organizers are concerned about having enough people to do presentations. Now, the beauty of speaking at one of these things is as you are speaking, a number of opportunities come up. So let's talk about getting the interview, right? As you are in the local community, whether you're at a hackathon, whether you're at a conference, or at a meetup, people will come up to you. Just like I said, they came up to me. And for me personally, every time I speak, somebody comes up and offers me a job, whether I want it or not, right? But that's because I'm making myself visible and because I'm talking about what I know. So they have a good sense of what I'm capable of. So for yourself, right, you've got to take the time to make yourself discoverable. And I'm sure a number of you have made yourself discoverable online, right, through your LinkedIn, Twitter, any sort of profiles you've got, maybe your GitHub account, and that's all great. But you also need to make yourself discoverable by speaking at these sorts of events. And it's not like you have to do it all the time, right? You can sort of set yourself a goal of once a quarter or maybe a stretch goal of once a month. And it doesn't have to be like you come up with a new talk every single time. I think people feel like they have to keep their material fresh. It is totally okay to come up with one talk and sort of give it over and over. Your audience will change. Your content, you'll notice, will start to change. You'll incorporate feedback. So don't hesitate to speak just because you feel like I've got to come up with something new every single time. Now, let's say you have one of these golden opportunities where after you speak, somebody comes up to you, right, and they say, we're really interested in hiring you, and we've got some open recs. Would you like to apply? Right? Well, this is where you kind of want to leverage your public speaking skills again, and it's not enough to just say, yes, like here's my resume, right? Take the time to find out who is the hiring manager. And that way you have a better sense that, yes, there is somebody who's actively hiring and you get put in touch with them. The second thing you want to know is how long has the position been open? And I'll explain why that's important in a little bit. And then the third is, a lot of times you'll read one of these job recs and there'll be a lot of levels or skills listed, like alphabet soup of technologies. And you're kind of thinking, like I only have one or two of those. I don't have like all 10, right? And the truth is, a lot of these are negotiable. People are sort of creating the description thinking, okay, this is like our ideal candidate. And they don't do a very good job of pointing out what the must-haves are from the nice-to-haves. So it's important to take the time to ask the hiring manager, what of these levels and skills do you feel is a must-have that your candidates coming in, need to have, versus what's a must-have? Like it would be nice for you to, for a candidate to have these things. And then finally, take the time to understand the culture and the organization, right? Is this a remote culture? Is this a culture where, everybody works in-house? Do they do long nights? Are they a little bit more flexible? And, what's the product and what's sort of their long-term vision? How many of you do all of this today, where you kind of grill the folks that give you an opportunity? Okay, someone said some of it, not all of it. So what is the sum of it that you're doing? Okay, I'll let you respond in a little bit. But you know, if you're not doing all these things today, take the time to do it. You're going to appear actually very polished as a candidate. And two, you're going to have a better sense of the company to be able to evaluate the opportunities. Okay. So the next thing that you want to do, right, is it's not enough for you to just get started and start interviewing, but you also want to take the time to answer some questions for them. And that means, what did you do before? What are you doing right now? And if you switched industries, like you were in finance, then you got into tech or something else, right? Make sure you have a good answer to why you made the switch. And excuse me, where are you headed next, right? What is the next opportunity that you're looking for? And you want to take all of this and do what I like to call a personal pitch, right? You've probably heard of investor pitches, which are like 30-second elevator pitches. This is similar, but a little bit different, in that you're going to be pitching yourself. But we're not going to make it, you know, too salesy, right? We're just going to give people a sense of who we are, what we do, and what we're looking for. And the way that a personal pitch works is you're going to have a goal in mind, and that goal might be the opportunity you're looking for, and then you want to make it really specific, right? So it is not a good idea to say, yes, I'm looking for a engineering position, or I'm looking for, you know, a junior engineer position or senior engineer position. Like, yeah, it's a little bit specific, but try to get even more specific. Like, I'm looking for a front-end position or a back-end, or I'm a full-stack engineer, right? Make it as specific as possible. And a lot of times when I say this, people will say, but if I make it specific, then people will say that they don't have an opportunity for me. Well, the truth is, if you make it so broad, then a lot of times people don't know where to place you. It's easier if you give them a specific interest, because then they can say, you know what, this company, it doesn't really have that position, but I know somewhere else that does. But if you make it so broad and you say, like, oh, I'm just looking to work at a startup, then it's like, okay, I know like hundreds of those, right? So try to make it as specific as possible, and then what your objective is. So to give you a simple example, here is a scenario where I kind of pulled this together from a couple of recent grads. And it says, I'm a recent grad who specializes in JavaScript development. Currently, I'm interested in working as a front-end developer for an e-commerce company in San Francisco. I'd love to work at a growth stage startup. Right? So pretty clear. You understand that this person is specializes in JavaScript. They graduated recently, and they even went so far as to specify the type of company that they want to work at. Now, if you don't have a sense of the type of company, that's okay, but it's good to do a little bit of research. At least in terms of, like, do we want to work at a startup versus a big company, and if it's in a particular space, or even mentioning things that you don't want, like if you don't want to do finance or you don't want to do gaming, right? It's okay to say those things. So how many of you have a personal pitch like this? Let me know in the chat box. Okay, somebody said yes. Great. Someone said not so specific. Okay, it looks like a couple people have and a couple people haven't. Hopefully, you will all take the time after this webinar to create your personal pitch then. But it's good to see that, you know, half of you have it and half of you don't have one yet. Okay. So let's talk about what to do before the interview, right? So before the interview, it's important to take the time to figure out who is going to be interviewing you, meaning everybody. If you've got four interviews scheduled at a company, then dive into each person's background. If they have a product that you can play with, then take the time to play with it. If it's a B2B business where they might not, then take the time to do some research about the company and the sort of services they offer and the type of customers they have. And then anticipate what the questions are going to be, because a lot of times I've noticed as I've done interviews all the way from interns to CTO level position, people don't take the time to kind of anticipate. In fact, I did probably 10 coding interviews last year, and 9 out of 10 of the people that showed up said, oh, I didn't realize this was going to be a coding interview, even though I specifically said you will be writing code, right? At least a little bit. So make sure you know what kind of interview it's going to be, what the format is. And then finally, have some projects that you can highlight. Even if it's a project that you did at your school or in a previous job, that's okay, right? But people want to understand the kind of work that you've done before, the environments that you're in, and then your specific contribution. So not your teams, not your companies, but your specific contributions to that, to those projects, and what the results were of those contributions. Now, it's totally okay to make mistakes, right? But there are a number of mistakes I see happening over and over again that are very fixable and will help you shine in the interview. So some of the common mistakes are being a know-it-all. And by being a know-it-all, I don't mean like answering every question correctly. What I mean by being a know-it-all is kind of padding your resume or whatever it is with all these different technologies that you may or may not be very well versed in, right? So put down what you feel 50 to 70% comfortable answering, but if you're just learning something new, don't bother putting it on because you don't want people to grill you on it. The next is jumping into problem solving. So whether you're doing a coding interview or some sort of business case study, whatever it is, right? I often see people that just kind of jump to the whiteboard and they haven't even fully sort of fleshed out what the problem is that we've put in front of them. And it is totally okay to say, let me understand this problem correctly before I dive in, kind of have that back and forth communication. And the reason this is really important is because sometimes interviewers will give you a super simple question and you might overly complicate it, and they're looking for that, right? So it might be like, oh, you literally wanted me to just reverse the string. I didn't know you wanted me to like, I thought you wanted me to like design the entire database for this, right? So they take the time to understand what they're looking for and what they're not looking for. And then finally, not asking questions at the very end. And I know sometimes interviewers can be bad about giving you time to do this, but if they give you even just 5 minutes or if there's some time left at the end, it is totally okay for you to jump up and say, hey, I'd like to ask you some questions about the work that you do here, what your role is, how you enjoy working, and what kind of development process you guys have. But be sure to ask every interviewer at least a couple questions. When you don't ask questions, it makes it seem like you're not interested in the position. Maybe you're just using this interview as a practice interview. Okay. So be sure to take the... Oh, somebody said there's no sound. You guys can hear me still, right? I figured, because otherwise Nicole would have said something. Okay, I'm going to keep going. So, this is the time where you want to take the time to interview them, right? It is totally okay in an interview situation. This is a two-way street. It's not just, you going to work for somebody, but, having a good environment that you can function and be productive in. And so what I mean by take the time to interview them, I mean actually find out what's the role, how does the team operate, and what is the long-term vision? And of course, if it's a smaller company or it's a startup, they might not have everything fully defined, but it's okay to hold them accountable to create some level of definition, right? And then go a little bit further and press them, even asking them things like, okay, especially if it's a bigger company, who was in this role before? What happened to them? What kind of promotion track do you guys have? And if you're okay with sharing it, what does it take to get promoted? And who was the last person that was promoted, right? The reason this is really important is because you want to make sure that this is an environment that is nurturing and cares about your career and the development of it. Okay, so let's move on to the offer, right? Now, a lot of times there's going to be, various types of offers on the table. Maybe it's an intern, contract to hire, etc. But you want to make sure you understand what the role is, what the salary is, the overall compensation. If you're going to work at a startup, is there equity or what else do they have to offer? And I put a link here for a video series that I've created as well as an equity compensation primer. Nicole will send you the slides afterwards so you can click on them and watch the video series and read the equity compensation. So when you get the offer, right, this is your chance to ask. And I know a lot of times people get really squeamish about asking for more money. They're like, oh, this was such a great offer. I don't really want any more. But the truth is that if you don't ask now, you can't ask later. And the reason you can't ask later is because later, there might be a budget cut. Later, they might say, well, this is kind of the position, and this is the amount of money for that position, and they kind of grade you on what your performance was, or later is just like not a good time, right? So it is better to negotiate in the period where you get the offer rather than trying to negotiate 3 months, 6 months, or a year later. The other thing is, a lot of times when you negotiate later, you're sort of capped to what you can get. It's usually like 4%, 5%, 10% increase unless you're really getting a promotion. So take the time to ask for whatever it is that you want in that offer period. And a lot of times people will say, well, you know, I don't think I deserve 10K or 20K or, you know, 10% or whatever. I think it's, you know, really what I deserve, right? But it's not about what you deserve. It's about what you can get, right? I know that sounds a little strange, and it might be fearful for a number of you out there, but it really is. And that's why you have to take the time to ask some of those probing questions. So I see somebody asked a question here, but if I ask more, I always fear they might take back the offer. Okay, that is a great question. So how many of you fear that somebody's going to take back the offer from you if you ask for more money? Oh, a lot of people. Wow, okay, that's interesting. Why would they take back the offer? I'd like to know why you guys think that they would take back the offer. Because, I mean, clearly, they put an offer out there. They're looking to hire. Okay, some people said because of their gender, they might have a negative image of me when I'm starting. They have other candidates with lower rates. Oh, okay, this is great. Okay, somebody asked, should I answer the question of what was my salary? Because they think that I'm too greedy. They think I'm asking for too much. Okay, that's great. I'm glad you guys have all of these these concepts in your head. So let me tell you a little secret about negotiating. When you ask for more money, you actually build credibility. Right, it's so bizarre, and of course, a number of you think they're going to take back the offer. They're going to think there's somebody else for less money. They might think, you know, who are you? You're just a junior developer. You just learned to code, or whatever it is, right? But the truth is, it actually builds credibility. And let me explain why it builds credibility. The first reason it builds credibility is because you personally know what you are worth, and not only that, but you're signaling to them that you know you can do the job. And you can do the job if you get paid a little bit more. When you don't, when you say, oh, okay, this is great, then people just say, oh, you know, Sally just accepted this offer. So in the future, when we're meeting a deadline that seems really aggressive, Sally will just do the work, no problem, right? Or, oh, you know what, we can't give promotions out this year. We've got budget cutbacks. Sally won't mind if we don't give her a promotion this year. Sally's good, you know? So you kind of set a standard that what you get offered is what you take, and you don't ask for anything more. So people kind of get this into their head that they can sort of just, you know, give you whatever and you'll accept it. But when you take the time to actually negotiate, you set a standard for people and say what is acceptable and what is not acceptable. So keep that in mind. And I do have an anecdote to share with you just to kind of drill the point home. I had a woman who reached out to me who was in my mailing list, and she said that, you know, she was an investor, and when she started at this new firm, she went in and they gave her an offer, and she accepted the offer. And when she started, one of the founding partners at the firm came up to her about a couple of weeks in and said, you know, I didn't really think anything of you because you didn't negotiate. And when you don't negotiate, to me, it means that you're not really going to go to bat for us, or you're not going to go to bat for companies, or you're not going to go to bat when we have to fundraise. Right, so this founding partner started to see signs when this woman didn't negotiate for a little bit more of a salary increase, right? So hopefully that drives the point home around what the credibility is. Now, I know you guys are still concerned about people taking back the offers and saying that it's not possible, or, you know, all these things, right? So what, right? So, you know, first off, they're not going to take back the offer. Most of the time, they're going to come back to you and say, that's not possible, or we can't do this, right? But nobody really takes back the offer. I can't think of a single person who has told me they took back the offer. The only time they take back an offer is If you have lied or you have misrepresented some information on your resume, or they did a background check and something came up, or one of your references didn't pass. But barring all of that, people don't take back an offer. Okay, so I know some people still have some questions around this, but what if I only just manage, okay, I'm gonna hold off on that. So they're concerned about their performance in the interview and then push for your salary. Okay, so first off, if you performed well enough, they're giving you the offer, right? Just because you didn't answer every single question 100%, like nobody answers every single question 100%. Even interviews that I've led where people were top-notch coders, they always kind of seem to fumble, maybe not on the coding questions, but on some of the culture questions or vice versa, right? So if they're giving you an offer, they are confident in your abilities, and it is totally okay for you to ask for more money, right? If they didn't think they were confident in your abilities, they wouldn't give you the offer. So hopefully this kind of helps you guys a little bit. Okay, so yes, somebody asked me, negotiate even as a junior, and would it be appropriate amount to negotiate without, what would be an appropriate amount to negotiate without overdoing it? So let's talk about that in my next slide. So I know somebody asked, is it okay to provide the exact compensation? No, it is not okay to provide exact compensation. So if somebody asks you, you know, what was your last salary or what was your recent salary, that is none of their business. In fact, it's actually an HR violation to do that. So if somebody does say, you know what, that was my previous job and I don't want to talk about that, I have since then done X, Y, and Z, so I believe I am worth more, and this is a range that I am looking for in terms of compensation. Now, in general, you don't want to be the person that anchors the conversation, meaning you don't want to start by saying how much you want. They need to tell you how much they're offering. And if they don't, you can actually say, you know, this seems really contradict, or this seems really abnormal. Most of the offers that I've gotten, people tell me what amount they're offering. So I would appreciate it if you would tell me what your base salary is that you're offering me, and then I can tell you whether it's within my range or not. Okay, so hopefully that makes sense to people. Now, the other thing, a lot of times people will say, what are the exact details of your competing offers? You know, you might have said, oh yeah, I've got this other company that's offered me a position and I've got 2 days or 2 weeks to respond to them, so I need to know whether you guys are giving me an offer, right? And then they might probe a little bit deeper and say, oh, so, you know, what's the compensation? Let us know. Again, none of their business. I remember when I was interviewing at my first job, one of the recruiters asked me for my additional offers, and I said, you know what, that's in a completely different part of the U.S. It's in North Carolina, and I'm looking for a job in California, and I know that the cost of living is more. So let's talk about what the offer is going to look like in California. Shut them up, and they put the offer out, right? So there is nothing wrong in holding your ground. Don't let them do unfair comparisons, whether it's location, whether it's a title, or whether it's even, you know, who you are versus like another candidate, right? Now, another is a lot of times people might give you an overly aggressive offer where they might say something like, you have 24 hours or 48 hours to get back to us. This is what's known as an exploding offer. This, again, is also not acceptable, right? This is putting a lot of pressure on you. And if you're going to go work for somebody for 8 to 10 hours a day, 5 days a week, they can at least give you the time to let you take a week to decide whether it's the appropriate culture or not, right? Again, it kind of hints at what their culture is going to be internally if they're that aggressive. They're probably going to have aggressive deadlines when it comes to shipping product and who knows what else, right? So tell them, you know, I understand that you have a tight deadline, but I would really like to have a week to think this over, talk about it with my partner, and get back to you. If that seems unreasonable, then I understand, but I think it's a lot of pressure to put on a candidate like myself who wants to make sure that I have a good fit at wherever I'm going. And again, this sends a signal that you know what you're doing, you're going to hold your ground, and that you're probably a better candidate for it. Okay, so I know I had a couple people ask, even as a junior, how would you negotiate, right? And a lot of times people are concerned about leverage because they're, again, it's that mentality of I've only been coding for 2 months, 2 years, whatever it is. Well, here's the secret. Remember I told you a few slides back that you need to know how long this position has been open, and you're kind of grilling the hiring manager and a lot of people that you're interviewing? This is the great time to use that. So if they say something like, oh yes, this position has been open for 3 to 6 months, right? What does that tell you about the position? it tells you that they're not getting a lot of good candidates. And they, in fact, gave you an offer because you were one of the good candidates that came out of that 3 to 6 month period, right? So knowing that, it is totally okay to say, so I recall you guys saying that, you know, you've been looking for a good candidate for the last 3 to 6 months, and since you gave me this offer, I am assuming, or I'm going to presume that I have met a lot of your criteria, and you think I'm going to be a good employee. Well, for me to take this offer, I would like to, you know, give a counter offer of X, at, you know, whatever your amount is, right? So that can be a way to create a little bit of leverage for yourself, knowing that they are desperate for a good candidate. So don't feel like you don't have any leverage. The fact that they are giving you an offer means that you have a lot of leverage, right? You have the opportunity to say yes. Okay, so should you negotiate even if it's your first job? Okay, so I want you all to walk away with just one thought from today's webinar, which is the following. You always negotiate. It doesn't matter if it's your first job, your fifth job, your tenth job, whatever it is, right? You always negotiate. Remember what I said, my first job, right, my first job out of college, the woman was offering me, I don't remember, it was like, it was back in 2004, so 10 years ago. So some base salary of like 50 or 55,000, and I went back and I said, I want 75. And of course, her response was, that's aggressive. And my response to that was, well, I would appreciate if you would check, right? And so I did a little bit of research, and my concern was really about the lifestyle and the cost of living in California. So she went and checked, came back, and offered me 66. Yes, it wasn't 75, but hey, it was 10K more than what the initial offer was, right? So you always negotiate. It doesn't matter if you are junior, if you are an intern, whatever it is, you always ask. And the reason that you ask is because the worst thing that can happen is somebody will come back and say no, right? But most of the time, 99% of the time I've seen negotiations, people come back and say, well, we couldn't do what you wanted, but here's where we can go, right? And so they usually give you a halfway point, right? Or maybe if you wanted more time off, or you wanted education assistance, or something else, right? Put all those things together. Or maybe there's a sign-on bonus. That was something else I asked for relocation, right? I was like, I got to move my stuff all the way across the country. I need a sign-on bonus of, you know, $10,000 or $15,000. And they were like, okay, fine. So don't hesitate to ask. Okay, so somebody else asked the question, I've been looking for a job for several months now. You just mentioned that if the position has been open for a while, it's fair to use that as leverage. Does that work for them too? Yeah, only if you tell them that you've been working for several months. Don't tell them you've been looking for several months, right? They don't need to know any of that information, right? It's totally okay to be like, yeah, I've been really busy, I've been coding, I've got projects, whatever, right? Nobody needs to know that you've been looking for a job for a year or 3 months. Yes, they might see it on your resume as a gap, and your response to that can be, you know, I have been, whatever it is that you have been doing in that time period. Have you been doing a side project? Have you been, you know, attending some online course? Or what have you been doing to keep busy, right? Or you can even say, you know, I took a little bit of time off. People understand that, right? But you don't have to say, oh, yes, for the last 3 months, I haven't been doing anything, and then I showed up to this interview, right? You can withhold some of that information. Okay, these are great questions. I'm glad you guys have asked all these, and hopefully I've sort of debunked a number of sort of misconceptions that you might have about negotiating your offer. All right, so let's do a quick review, and then I'll give you guys more time to ask any questions that you have. So the first thing we talked about is opportunities, right? We talked about how public speaking is going to get people to see you, you're going to be a lot more visible, and you're going to control the message and by sharing what you have worked on. And it's often more preferable to doing those awkward networking events because people come up to you, they want to develop deeper relationships. And we talked about how you can figure out your expertise by using the inventory method, right? Thinking about the work that you've done for the last 3 to 12 months. And then when it comes to getting the interview, right, as you are speaking, people are going to come up to you and ask you if you're interested in an opportunity, but it's important to take the time to figure out who the hiring manager is, what the role is, you know, what they're looking for, and then taking the time to develop and do some background before you show up to the interview and looking at your previous projects, getting some practice in, doing some practice interviews, doing some practice whiteboard sessions, but then also taking the time to understand what their product is and asking them good questions in the interview process. And not just questions related to like their product, but also questions related to career development and holding them accountable to that. And then finally, like I said, the one takeaway, right, from this webinar should be you always ask. And you always ask during that offer period, right? Do not fear somebody taking the offer away from you. I'm going to kind of give you a guarantee that that's not going to happen as long as, remember, your background checks pass, your reference checks pass, and you haven't lied about anything on your resume, then no one is going to take the offer back, right? If the company is going down, they might take the offer back, but then you don't want to work there to begin with. Right? So realize they're most likely going to meet your counter offer or get as close to it as possible. Okay? And since you guys all attended today, I'm giving you a free ebook copy of my latest book, Present a Techie's Guide to Public Speaking. It's got a lot more methods in it. And if you click on this link, again, Nicole's going to send you the slides. You can get both the ebook as well as the audio version. All right? So with that, let's go ahead and stop right there. And let me know if you guys have any additional questions on stuff that I've covered. Nicole, are there any questions on Twitter or anything else that you saw coming up?
I think you have answered a lot of the questions here. It was super engaging. So thank you so much for joining us. We might have just had one more question come in. Could you clarify what you mean by taking time to do the research on the job or company in the time between making a connection at the presentation and your first email intro to him or her?
Yeah. So what I mean by that is, let's say, you know, simple example. Let's say Google comes up to you, right? And they say, yeah, we'd love for you to interview with us. And that's the time to dig in a little bit more and ask, okay, can you give me the contact info of the hiring manager? I'd like to follow up with them. I'd like to know kind of what divisions are, what products are hiring today, and just kind of dive in a little bit deeper, because what you're trying to gauge, again, is what's the position? How long has it been open? You know, what kind of candidates they're looking for, to figure out if it is a good fit for you to continue with the interview process, or you feel like, no, it's not, you know, the right place, or it's not the right role for you.
Awesome. And I think, yeah, we have time for one more question here, which is, how long should the speech at the beginning of your interview be? 1 minute, 5 minutes? What do you suggest?
Oh, the personal pitch? Well, the personal pitch actually is, I'm hoping that's what you're asking, but the personal pitch is something that you just do, like let's say somebody comes up after you speak at an event and they say, you know, great talk, blah, 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 or maybe they didn't necessarily attend your talk or whatnot. It's really just an opportunity for you to showcase who you are, what you've worked on, and what you're looking for. You don't usually do like a speech at the beginning of an interview. I think if people ask what you're looking for and, you know, you get those kind of questions over and over again, then you might want to have just a little 20, 30 second intro. Some of that could be from your personal pitch, but it doesn't have to be things that are like overly rehearsed, right? You want to be able to speak authentically.
Awesome. Well, that was super insightful. I just want to thank everyone for joining us here today, and especially Purnima for being our guest on this webinar. As she mentioned, we'll be sending out a link to the recording tomorrow, but feel free to, you know, continue asking questions on Twitter and tagging us, and we'll continue answering. And, you know, we hope to see you online learning to code and downloading the awesome book that she sent the link for, which we'll include in the follow-up email as well. Thanks again for joining us, and we hope to see you on our next webinar.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. And if there was any questions that I didn't answer, feel free to just message me on Twitter. I'm @Purnima.
Bye.
Hi.